Steel is one of the most important metals in the world. From morning until night, it serves us every day. Steel helps us grow our food and cook our meals. It is used in tools, buildings, automobiles, and many other things. From thumbtacks to locomotives, what does this picture suggest? A bicycle is nearly all steel. Rubber, leather, and glass also serve useful purposes on the bicycle. However, an average bicycle weighs 35 pounds, and approximately 30 pounds of it are steel. Steel appears in the bicycle in a number of forms. Can you pick them out? Iron ore, coal, and limestone are the three most important raw materials used in making iron and later steel. Certain other raw materials, such as scrap, are also needed by the steel industry. Although some are used in small amounts, they are all very important. These special materials are used in making alloy steels and super steels, such as the steel for ball bearings in bicycle or steel for the parts of a jet engine. Alloy steels are made by adding small amounts of special materials to in plain steel while it is still liquid or molten. The principal raw materials for making iron and steel are found in many states. Fortunately, this country has large supplies of these materials. This has made it possible for the United States to be the largest steel producer in the world. Now look at the map. Where are the chief deposits of iron ore, bituminous coal, and limestone? Now notice the location of the steelmaking centers. Can you explain why the steelmaking centers are developed and where they are? This is an open-pit mine, located in the Mesabi Range in Minnesota. It is the largest man-made hole in the world and is about 3 miles long and half a mile wide. It is called an open-pit mine because the iron ore lies so near to the surface of the earth that the ore can be scooped up by power shovels. The shovels load the ore into railroad cars, which carry the ore to docks in Lake Superior. Huge ore boats, twice as long as a football field, carry the iron ore down the Great Lakes for use in the steel mills. This boat is being loaded at an ore dock on Lake Superior. Chutes are lowered from the storage bins above the water, and the ore flows down, filling the boat. Already, 4 chutes have been lowered onto this boat. Here we are looking into the bins of an ore boat while it is being unloaded. At the center of this picture is a long steel arm with a big bucket on the end. You can just see the top of the bucket. It has jaws which open and close. The long arm pushes the bucket down into the boat, and the bucket takes a mouthful of ore weighing 20 tons. Then the long arm moves up and dumps the ore back on the land. The second raw material used by the steel industry is bituminous, or soft coal. Most coal is mined deep in the ground. The machine which you see here cuts a slice 8 feet deep into the two sides of a block of coal. Next, the block is blasted loose, then another machine with a mechanical arm gathers up the coal and loads it into mine cars, drawn by an electric locomotive. Further on, the loaded cars are then emptied into a conveyor belt, which takes the coal out of the mine to the plant, where the coal is crushed and cleaned. Coal, as it comes from the earth, cannot be used in the iron-making furnace. It must be first changed into coke. Coke is made by heating coal in special ovens. The big square machines at the center, which runs on rails, is dumping coal into the top of one of the ovens. Limestone is the third raw material needed in making iron and steel. It is obtained from quarries. Great chunks of limestone are blasted loose and loaded by power shovels into railroad cars or trucks. The limestone is taken to a plant where the big rocks are crushed into smaller pieces, just the right size for iron and steel-making furnaces. Limestone is also mined underground in some parts of the country. The first step into making steel is to change the iron ore into molten iron in blast furnaces. This shows how blast furnaces look on the outside. There are 2 furnaces in this picture, at the extreme right and left. The one at the right can be seen clearly. A blast furnace is about 10 stories high. Notice the slanted track going to the top of each furnace. Little cars, called skip cars, go up the track with loads of iron ore, coke, and limestone, and dump them into the top of the furnace. The round objects between the 2 furnaces are stoves, which heat air for the furnaces. At the front of the picture is a storage pile of iron ore. This cross-section drawing shows how a blast furnace works. At the top is a heating stove. Hot air comes out near the bottom and is blown into the blast furnace at the right. The furnace is made up of steel and lined with heat-resistant brick. The loaded skip car travels up the gray track on the left behind the stove to the top of the furnace. There it dumps into the furnace the 3 kinds of raw materials most important in the making of iron. The hot air rushes upwards, making the coke burn at terrific heat. Gradually, the iron melts from the ore and forms into drops, which trickle to the bottom of the furnace. Meanwhile, the limestone joins with the impurities and form a scum called slag. Slag is lighter than molten iron and floats on top of the hot metal. Every 6 hours, the iron is run from the furnace into a big bucket called a ladle. The slag is drawn off separately. Quiz! What are the three most important raw materials used in making iron? In what region of the United States is iron ore mined? What states have important steelmaking centers? How is iron ore carried to the steel mills? What is the name of the furnace which changes iron ore into iron? Molten iron, as it comes from the blast furnace, has some impurities. To change the iron into steel, the impurities must be burned out. This is done in three different kinds of furnaces. 1. Bessemer converter. 2. Open hearth furnace. 3. Electric furnace. All of the furnaces are made of steel and lined with heat-resistant brick. The Bessemer converter is charged with molten iron and scrapped. Charging, in the steel industry, means putting raw materials into the furnace. The open hearth is charged with limestone, steel scrap, and molten iron. The electric furnace is charged with scrap only. Steel scrap consists of worn-out pieces of steel, such as used car bodies, railroad rails, and machinery. Most scrap is obtained from the trimmings which are left over in steel mills and other manufacturing plants. In the furnaces, the scrap is melted and changed into fresh steel. To make steel in the Bessemer converter, the converter is tipped on its side. The molten iron is charged into its mouth, and then a powerful blast of air is blown through the molten iron into the converter. The air enters through many holes in the bottom of the furnace. Oxygen in the air makes the impurities in the hot iron catch on fire. Then flames and smoke roar from the top of the converter. After 10 to 15 minutes, the impurities are burned out of the iron, and it has become steel. The converter is tipped forward, and the hot steel runs into a big ladle. When the air is blown through the molten iron in the Bessemer converter, you can see the greatest display of fireworks in all the steel industry. This is the glow from steel mills that lights up the night sky for miles around. This cross-section drawing shows how the open hearth furnace works. In many ways, it's like a huge oven. The charging machine is dumping a load of material into the furnace. The long arm of the machine is withdrawn while the steel is being made. Then the furnace doors are closed. Tongues of flame play over the materials, melting them and burning out impurities. After 8 to 12 hours, a hole in the back of the furnace is open, and the steel is run into a ladle. Here you see the charging machine at the center of the picture. It is pushing a long steel arm with a box load of limestone or scrap through one of the furnace doors. Open hearth furnaces produce 90% of all the steel that is made in this country. After the limestone and scrap have been heated in an open furnace for a couple of hours, molten iron is poured from a huge ladle, one of the most thrilling sights in a steel mill. The ladle is held overhead by an electric crane. The man in the picture is signaling to the crane operator, whom you cannot see. He is telling the operator how much to tip the bottom of the ladle in order to pour the steel into the furnace. Notice that he is standing well back from the shooting sparks. This is the cross-section drawing of an electric furnace. It is being tilted forward to pour out the steel. Electric furnaces are used to make the finest kinds of alloy steel, such as the stainless steel for instruments which surgeons use when they operate. Steel scrap is put into the furnace through a door at the left. The three large rods which you see reaching down into the furnace are called electrodes. Powerful electric currents shoot down through the electrodes and jump across into the scrap like flashes of artificial lightning. The electric flames are very hot and melt the scrap into fresh steel. Molten alloy steel is being poured from an electric furnace into the ladle at the center of this picture. Pouring steel from an electric or open hearth furnace is called tapping the furnace. Here you see steel being poured into ingot molds from a huge ladle held by an electric crane. The man standing in the middle of the platform uses a long lever to open the valve in the bottom of the ladle to let out the steel. It pours into each mold, filling it to the top. You can plainly see three molds that have been filled. After the steel has hardened in the mold, it's called ignit. This is the first solid form into which steel is made. This step is called teeming. Which steelmaking furnace produces most of the steel made in this country? What is steel scrap? What kind of furnace uses a strong blast of air to refine molten iron into steel? What kind of furnace uses heat from electricity to make steel? What is the first solid form in which most steel is made? While the steel is hardening into an ingot, it cools slightly on the outside. It must be heated again to make it hot enough to be rolled in a rolling mill. Here is a furnace called a soaking pit, where the ingot is soaked in heat to about 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. One ingot is down in the pit. The other ingot is being lifted out by a pair of tongs. The man on the right operates the soaking pit cover. White hot steel is fairly soft and can be squeezed into various shapes under strong pressures in much the same way that modeling clay can be shaped in your hands. This is done by passing the hot steel between powerful steel rolls, which work somewhat like a clothes wringer. An ingot is generally rolled into three basic shapes called blooms, billets, and slabs. These shapes are known as semi-finished steel because they must be given further rolling in finishing mills. Ingots are rolled into blooms, billets, and slabs in separate rolling mills called blooming, billet, and slab mills. A bloom is generally rolled into long shapes such as rails for railroads and beams for bridges, buildings, and television towers. Some billets are rolled into long, round lengths of steel called rods. They are about as thick as a lead pencil and may be a mile long. Some rods are formed into wire. Billets are also rolled into bars, which have thousands of uses. The greatest use of bars is making parts for automobiles. Slabs are rolled into flat sheets such as plate, sheet, and strip. Plate is used where the strength of a thick, flat sheet is needed, such as the hull of a ship or the walls of a gasoline storage tank. Steel sheets are thinner than plates and have thousands of uses, such as automobile bodies and refrigerators. Steel strip is as thin as sheets, but is narrower. It is manufactured into thousands of products, including toys and razor blades. We have seen how men and machines are in use to obtain iron ore, limestone, and coal, the principal raw materials for making steel. We saw how they load and carry the iron ore down the Great Lakes. We saw the ovens where they change coal into coke. We watched them take the iron ore, coke, and limestone and make molten iron in the blast furnaces. We saw how the iron is changed into steel in three types of furnaces. We also saw how skilled men work various kinds of rolling mills to shape the steel into different forms and sizes. Other manufacturers buy these steel products and make them into thousands of useful things for modern living. Here is our bicycle again. In our journey through the steel industry, we saw how the steel in the bicycle was only once iron ore in the ground. It took furnaces and machinery and thousands of skilled men to change the iron ore into steel. Around the bicycle, we saw a few of the hundreds of other useful steel objects we use in our daily lives. How is an ingot made hot enough for rolling in a rolling mill? What is the principal way that steel is formed into different shapes in a steel mill? What steel shapes are rolled from blooms? How many things can you name that are made from steel, sheet, and strip? How many steps can you describe in the making of steel, beginning with the iron ore in the ground?